When David's chariot arrived, there were several newcomers with him. They were newly arrived saints of the earth. They were glorifying God in cheers of praise. Their faces radiated and were beaming the light and glow of heaven. David said to us, "I'll see you later, go where you want and enjoy, but I must take these dear brothers upstream of the river, on the side of the gate of Manasseh, where they will spend a little time among the trees that you can see there in the distance." When the vehicle drove off, the strings of David's harp vibrated with the accents of Psalm 24, all of them singing. My mother now said, "I would like to introduce you to these four beautiful brothers coming. They are the most joyful souls I have met in a long time. I often meet them in the city and I know them well." While these brothers were approaching, I asked Mom who they were. She replied that they were the martyred saints. They were all burnt at the stake for their testimony of our Lord. "Oh Mother, I shall be so glad to meet them." "Me too," said my daughter Mary. When these brothers were close to us, I noticed a wonderful halo of glory surrounded them. "Good morning," said Mother. Every one of them indeed replied good morning. In fact, in heaven, even long after entering paradise, or long after crossing the gates of a heavenly region, it's always as if the morning had just begun. One feels so refreshed, so happy and light-hearted. Then these brothers greeted us with a lovely bow and handshake. We were introduced to them and a lively conversation followed. It was truly a joyful conversation. Their laughter was holy and celestial, and their expressions of joy filled my soul with the happiness and praise of God. I said, "Mother just told me that you are of those who once suffered martyrdom for Christ's sake." "That's true," said one of them. "We keep the memory of those days of terrible persecution as if it was yesterday, but several hundred years have passed since, and here we are largely rewarded for it. They had tried to force us to deny our faith, but it was not possible. The words of our Lord were too near our hearts. He said, 'Do not be afraid of those who kill the body and cannot kill the soul, rather fear him who is capable of destroying both the soul and the body in hell.'" Matthew 10:28. It is true, our sufferings have been intense, but they ended quickly. And immediately, we were introduced into this glory. And leaping out of our bodies, we shouted victory on fire and on our enemies. As these brothers uttered these words, I thought of the scripture where John the beloved disciple said, "I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer, until the full number of their fellow servants, their brothers and sisters, were killed just as they had been. Revelation 6:10. Then these brothers said, "Our rest has been most sweet among these bowers and cradles of paradise and the glories of the eternal city." Then one of them said, "It's like when old soldiers meet and remember their struggle together." These brothers said, "Actually, we were on our way to a great meeting concerning those who had been martyrs, and those who professed our Lord during the dark periods of persecution that the earth has known, and in a very short time you will see many celestial chariots transporting thousands of these martyrs to this gathering. In fact, here in heaven we call it excursion to the hills. We would be pleased to have you come along with us if you want." Marie quickly replied, "Yes, let's go." Then we joined them without delay, and we walked to the nearby station. And while we were waiting for a chariot at the station, I said to my mother and Mary, "Really, I am very happy to go to this meeting. I heard so much about the terrible days of persecution and of the thousands of Christians who were killed by fire and the sword. In Rome, Nero's persecution was a terrible time, when he burnt so many of the saints. He coated their undressed bodies with pitch and transformed them into torches for the night. The cry of their agony was the music of his chariot races." "It was terrible," said Mother, "but they are all here now with the glory of God upon them. No doubt we will meet many of them soon." "Look," said Mary, "do you see the chariots coming?" "Oh yes, in the distance," I said, "but do they pass round here? Is their route past this station?" "I think so," said one of the saint on the station waiting like us. Then he waved his flowing cape and a driver saw him and made a turn in our direction. As the chariot got close, I noticed that there were several cars or coaches attached to it, just like the trains on earth. I do not know the propulsion system of these celestial chariots. The propelling power of these heavenly vehicles was unknown to me, but it was something resembling to terrestrial electric power that mightily operated these wonderful vehicles of heaven. I will talk to you about it later." As the chariot slowed its speed and drew near to us, we all boarded and we were greeted by hundreds of the most cheerful people I have met in heaven. The chariot moved on with wonderful rapidity toward the recreation and pleasure parks and hillsides of paradise. We passed mountainous regions of the city. After some time, when at last we finally slowed down, as a huge and immense crowd were gathered and assembled from all sections of the celestial kingdom, and it was mainly those who had been beheaded and martyred for Christ's sake. Many of them had suffered prison, interrogation and torture, torment and torture that no one has ever reported. Others had been shredded by wild beasts in the arena for the entertainment of the wicked. We saw a lot of those to whom it is referred in the holy book that now rests on your table. Because it speaks of Gideon and Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, prophets and others who have experienced the cruel test of mockery and whip, or chains and imprisonment. We saw those who had been stoned, sawn in two, tortured, those who were slain by the sword, who wandered here and there, dressed in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, afflicted, tormented, whom the world was not worthy, who wandered in deserts and mountains, and in dens and caves of the earth. Hebrews 11:32. There was among them James, who was killed by Herod by the sword. There was Stephen, who was stoned. In fact, almost all the apostles were there. We saw also Latimer and Thomas Hawkes, and a hundred others beside them who had suffered martyrdom in England during the reign of the one who is called the Bloody Mary, but with thousands of others who had sealed their testimony with their own blood. They were truly the most joyous of all the men I had met in the heavenly kingdom. I had before my eyes the spectacle of overflowing joy and the acclamations of praise of this great army of saints, that neither fire, nor sword nor prison had been able to divert from the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus. I was constantly thinking of this verse of the book of Revelation of John, where it says, "I saw the souls of them who were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads, nor in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years." Revelation 20 verse 4. Just at this time the Apostle Paul approached us. Seeing that I was a newcomer to this great festivity, he asked me, "Have you been a martyr for Jesus?" I said no, but I love him intensely. "I hope I am not intruding." "Oh no," he said, "you are very welcome among us." I was then emboldened to ask for an explanation as to the verse I have just quoted. "Certainly," he said. "This immense crowd who suffered for Christ on earth will also reign with him on earth. We are at the dawn of the millennium, and for 1,000 years these martyrs will be greatly honored in the midst of the heavenly multitude, when the Lord will return to earth with all his saints. They will reign with him. It is an honor that belongs to all martyrs. For those who suffer with him will reign with him." Then the great assembly had finished its work session, because in heaven we take care of many activities. After that came the praise service. The enthusiasm and spiritual activity were such that they would shame most of the church gathering on the earth. The harps and other celestial instruments in the hands of these trained chorists simply made the vaults and domes of heaven vibrate. The souls who had experienced trial and suffering who composed this immense assembly produced the sweetest and the most beautiful melodies that were. I was really completely baffled and bewildered considering the development and capabilities of the human soul in heaven. Then there was a heavenly picnic. There was so much joy and satisfaction, so much demonstration of praise and victory that nothing on earth could be compared to this. There were fruits of all kinds with the spices and dishes of the eternal kingdom that were prepared for the meal. It was the angels who busied themselves with this service. It was difficult for me to realize the multitude of good things that had been prepared for the saints. There was such an abundance. There was so much joy and satisfaction. After they finished eating, they began by the thousands to walk through the valleys and hills, and among the mountains of paradise. Everywhere in the surrounding places abounded immense gorges with prodigious cataracts, as well as landscapes of great beauty, with everywhere many of places of rest and recreation, flowers of constantly blossoming, Groves of trees and grassy carpets, with their infinite varieties, brought their reward to those who in this blessed paradise rested with eternal satisfaction from their earthly works. At the close of the great convocation, my mother came to me and said, "Son, have you noticed there is no race prejudice in heaven? No distinctions of the races?" "Yes, mother, there are distinctions but no prejudice because of race. It makes no difference here as to the kind of skins or bodies we had on earth. All souls have a spotless whiteness like cloud, and their robes as well. Whatever the physical differences we may have had on earth, we are all one family here. Children of one father. Do you notice the group of singers yonder?" "Yes, I do, mother. They were all black people of America. Some of them suffered much as slaves by their old masters. Let us go and speak to them for a moment." And we went there. To my great surprise, I quickly recognized one of them. We stood face to face, but for a moment I hesitated, and I said, "In the name of paradise, is this Eurastus?" "Oh," he said, "it's me, but I wonder if it's you." I said to him, "Look again." He did, and he began to smile and said, "I recognize you, Mr. Sodi. You preached to colored folks once on board of the vessel on the North Sea," and with that he gave me his hand. I knew Erastus in my earlier years, having business with his old master in the south. He was really ebony and very ignorant, but his face now shone with the brightness and radiance of heaven itself, and his garments were perfect and purest whiteness. "Well, I am glad to meet you," he said. "Indeed it is mutual," I replied, "but you are so changed. Are there no black faces in heaven?" I asked. He said, "We are all white as cloud here, and in the perfect image of the Lord." Then I asked Trastus, "What about your former master?" He said, "I fear he is not here. I've never met him since the day I escaped. I went to northern Russia thanks to the boat you know very well about. I could not take the whipping from him anymore. When the boat was full of cotton balls, I hid between the balls until I was off. Then I had to leave my hiding place because of hunger and thirst. Several times he threatened to throw me into the sea like Jonah. But my life was spared, and I was able to escape to Russia. I have never seen him in this celestial kingdom. I have passed to and fro among these countless hosts of the redeemed. I went in many sections of the city, but I have not seen him. I fear he is not here. He used to attend the services of his church and made a good profession on Sunday, but during the week he was ungodly and rough to his children and worse to his slaves. I have come to realize the depth of the folly of those who serve the Lord one the seventh day of the week, while serving the devil the other 6 days. They strive to be good on Sunday, but they let the devil lead them the rest of the week. I was poor in the world. My cabin had no window, nor did we have rag of a carpet on the floor, nor a picture on the wall. Neither did we have a flower in the yard, nor did we have a yard, for cotton grew even by the door. But I have everything here. Everything I see is mine, and everything belonged to us here. I am free to go where I want, up and down the streets, through the long avenues. I can walk along the streets and on the long avenues. In one way or another, I can enter the gates of the city in the beautiful chariots of God, and I can go to countless or infinite regions of paradise. The Lord Jesus gave me the total freedom. He said to me, "Go wherever you want, go eat all the fruit of trees that you want, go climb the mountains and the valleys along rivers, let your soul bathe in the Son of the Lamb, who is the light of all the heavenly city and this paradise." "Well, Rastus," I said to him, "I am very glad to meet you here and witness how God has lifted you up from the dust and the dunghill and made you a prince among his saints. Indeed, I am the object of his grace and you are the witness. But when did you arrive in the city?" He asked me. I replied, "It is my first visit to paradise after having been in the city only a short time. I have only just begun to see my inheritance." He said, "Well, you will never get tired watching the great mysteries of the eternal city. Your heart will overflow with the highest emotions of praise. But do you see my harp? I keep it tuned up all the time, ready to praise of the Lord Jesus. If only one day in one of these roads I could meet my old master, I believe that the angels would have to minister the first reproach in heaven, saying to me, 'Do not play so loud, you will disturb the children meeting in the Fourth Avenue.' But I fear I shall never meet him, for God says that nothing shall ever enter into the city that is unclean, nor shall any man practicing abomination and falsehood. but only those whose names are written in the Book of Life of the Lamb. My master was raping women of the plantation, and he encouraged others to do the same, but on Sunday he concealed all this, and had the appearance of a holy man. I fear that his tears will be without hope and that he will never reach the throne or this eternal kingdom. Then I said, tell me, Rastus, what about other slaves? Are there many in this celestial kingdom? My dear Mr. Sodhi, I think you have not recognized them because they put on their skin and body of light instead of their skins. They are multitudes of them here and they sing in choirs with other people, and often their voices are stronger. Obviously not all of them are here, because many of them were as hypocritical as their masters. Some were violent and terrorized others. Others did not believe in God, others were liars, and God says that those who practice these will have their share in the lake of fire and suffering. If only I could go back to earth and see them again for the last time. I would take this golden harp, I would show them this garment of light, I would bring them a cluster of these fruits, they would believe me, though they believe neither Moses nor the prophets. Rastus, to see you have been a very interesting encounter for me. Me too, said Rastus. But I see that my company is scattering. I have to go too. See you soon, we'll meet again, I'm sure. After saying goodbye to me, Rastus disappeared among the carriages and the thousands of redeemed who left the great gathering of martyrs. It was really a blessing. I said to my mother that there is no longer the slightest feeling of segregation in regard to anyone who has been judged by God to pass through the gates of the eternal kingdom. Yes, she said, we come from all nations, from all races, from all languages, from all peoples. And all are in the image of their Lord, though POP have retained a peculiar resemblance to what they were before on earth. But look! David is coming with his celestial car. A few moments later we boarded and we seated with him in the chariot, and we were flying at great speed towards the gate of the eternal city. We entered by the gate of Menasi, and we parked the heavenly vehicle near the great university of children, the Children Polytechnic. Mom and Marie jumped off the heavenly vehicle, and I bade them goodbye saying, I hope to see you again, because David was supposed to take me on a flying trip through some of the great avenues of the celestial city toward the throne. David said to me, I see that your heart is turned in the direction of the throne. He said to me, I was asked to be your servant for a time. Then we went through streets and avenues of the eternal kingdom flying at unmeasured speed. Then we began to distinguish in distance the light emanating from the throne. The light from the throne were luminous in the distance. Even the trees that lined up along the great arteries, much like those on the earth, were shading the streets. They seemed to have like diamonds and sparkling rubies hanging from their branches, and the heavenly palaces seemed to be sprinkled with diamonds and rubies of glistening brightness. We then reached a broad avenue which led to the throne. Thousands of glorified souls were moving towards the throne, others were returning from it, some were walking and engaged in holy conversations. Others were in celestial vehicles carrying them with joy and rest of heaven. I turned to David and I said, at the same time that I am impatient to go to the throne, I have also the deep desire to see again the woman who was my intimate in life companion on earth. I was told that she is in a fairly remote place in paradise. Then David said, why did not you say it when we were in paradise? We could have gone there quickly, but I will change direction and get there right away because I know her well. I know she will be very happy, and I would be very glad to do you the service of making this great journey with pleasure. David asked me, do you have a preference for a route? I replied, I do not know directions here, but if you can go to the Children's University and take my mother and my daughter Marie, but I really don't know the itineraries, so you will have to choose the way for me. With great pleasure, said David, and at the speed of sound we proceeded in the direction of the Children Amphitheater Gate. It did not take us very long to find ourselves at the gate. We were supposed to tour a distant and remote section of paradise where my wife, my life companion, was busy assisting a large number of souls entering heaven. These souls came from certain non-Christians' countries where the missionaries were busy preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus. So as we were waiting in the chariot at the gate of Children Polytechnic, I saw my mother and my daughter Mary passing near the place, and I signaled to them to join us. When I told them about my great desire to see my wife and David's pleasing offer to assist me, they accepted our invitation without hesitation, and they boarded in the celestial car. Then my mother said, I know very well where she is, at one of the remote stations far beyond the Gate of Benjamin. So David turned the chariot to the right, saying, I'm going down the 92nd Avenue, and then we will exit at the Benjamin Gate. My soul was filled with sweet and rapture of delights as I had never known since the moment we had left the Gate of Judah. On our first entrance into the city where we were received by the Lord Jesus, the thoughts of the family reunion were so precious and delightful to me. My mother and daughter were seated by my side, David the sweet singer of Israel were at our service by the command of the Lord. He who led the hosts of the servants of the Most High and fought his battles was now at our service, and we were soon to meet the beloved wife of my youth, who for so many years served his Lord in this eternal kingdom. What a blessed morning was this one! My whole soul was overwhelmed with happiness at the thought of meeting her. David asked me if I was ready, then he started the celestial vehicle and we crossed what was for me a new section of the celestial city. My mom and Marie seemed to be particularly at home, and accustomed to this neighborhood. I said to my daughter Marie, you have not known the experience of separations from loved ones as you died when you were only 3 months, and you do not know the sorrows and tears which we knew on earth. By God's grace you escape all these earthbound emotions, and you also escape the darkness of sins in the world. The moment you died you became eternally safe. Oh, indeed I am safe and very happy in my experience. I know nothing of the sorrow and tears of which you speak of. Others people often told me of their sad mistakes and their sin-burdened hearts, but how thankful they all are for our blessed Redeemer. Without him I would have been lost and I would never have seen nor entered this celestial world. David began to slacken the speed of the chariot, and he said to me, I want you to notice what we are passing now. On both sides of the great avenue there were multitudes of peculiar yet most beautifully constructed mansions. There were multitudes of houses very beautiful but of a very particular design and architecture. David said they were built according to the tastes and fancies of their occupants, as are all the multiple houses you noticed. I do not doubt the wide variety of landscapes and buildings across the city. Everyone can choose his house, and change the architecture as he wants. God himself delights in variety, and he has made no two blades of grass alike, neither two grains of sand, nor two human souls alike. But communities in the world with similar choices, education and fancies, naturally group together here. That is why you see these dwellings so special. You can see how happy and fully satisfied are those who form this great colony here in this part of heaven. My mother then spoke and said to David, I've been here for many years but I have never seen anyone who is not satisfied, or who is not in peace, or who is nostalgic for his earthly house. It seems that our heavenly Father anticipated the desires of all his people, and that he thus organized and arranged this eternal kingdom so that each one finds the answers to all his desires. David said to me, the city with all the variety of its architectures and constructions, with its fruits, rivers and fountains is adapted to all the nations of the earth. Here in this eternal city are gathered the innumerable crowds that come from all nations, from all families, from all peoples, from all languages. Multitudes coming from pagan nations, especially their children are here in great numbers, for they did not reach the age of responsibility as early as in Christian houses. They are all saved by virtue of redemption, as long as they have not sinned against eternal light. That is why they are here gathered by the thousands and they grow up to maturity. These toddlers are taught by the faithful servants in the regions of paradise. That's where we are heading. I asked David, could we go faster? I am so anxious to see her again, my sweet companion of life. The celestial vehicle accelerated and reached the speed of sound. The avenue was a place of pure delight. Trees loaded with ripe fruit. Houses were varied and beautiful. Thousands of joyful souls coming and going, some of them resting on the cushions and the celestial upholstery. We were traveling with great speed and we passed thousands of houses without being able to distinguish them from each other. Then my daughter Marie said, look at the gate down there. I asked, are we close to the wall and the entrance to celestial kingdom? David slowed down the chariot. I raised my eyes to examine again the immense wall and all its splendors. The gate was open as usual, We passed through Benjamin's gate with its glittering pearl and its shiny golden hinges. We had only time to cast one glance backward to say goodbye to the city, and realize that we were already several leagues on one of the great roads of paradise. Marie leaned her head on my shoulder. "Papa, do you appreciate the music and the hum of the wheels of the heavenly car?" "Usually they are hardly heard," I said. "Oh, you know, I'm overwhelmed by the immensity and majesty of heaven." "Tell me, Mom, how long do you think we will reach the station?" "Very soon. I believe that I can now see the domes and arrows of the mission. What glory!" I said. "Look at these mountains, hills and valleys that we cross. My soul is full of wonder." David immediately took his harp and we all again sang the victories of the Lamb. The car was now on the outside of a huge arch overlooking one of the sections of paradise preparations. We all jumped outside. And to my surprise, more than 100 of the most gracious people came to greet us. All of them reflected the glory and light of heaven. I did not need a presentation, especially with regard to one of them, absolutely charming, the finest among hundreds. She sprang literally from the middle of the group, exclaiming glory to God in the very high places. She threw herself on my neck, but could not weep. I did not either, for no one can weep in heaven. But the cup of our joy was filled. "I knew you were coming," said my wife Genevieve, "but I did not know David would bring you. Oh, I'm so glad you're home now. And you also came with Mom and our daughter?" Then Genevieve took both of them in her arms and hugged them. I said, "Dear Genevieve, since my arrival in paradise, I was very anxious to see you again, but it was not possible to reach you sooner. So now we have realized the dreams that we had on earth concerning our future. Our prayers have been fulfilled. Finally, we are really at home."